Review. The Dartmouth Review is an independent campus newspaper with a national reputation for challenging the liberal status quo. Harmeet and her fellow student journalists sparked a national debate about students' free speech rights when they published an article critical of school policies, and faculty and administrators responded harshly. The school's severe public condemnation of the students caught the attention of the New York Times. In an interview with the New York Times in 1988, Harmeet said, "I'm very disturbed by the response to the article. I'm very surprised, very, very surprised. I suspect," and you can ask Harmeet about this in Q&A, "but I suspect that Harmeet is no longer very surprised by school administrators' contempt of students' free speech rights." Harmeet earned her law degree at the University of Virginia and now leads a distinguished law practice in San Francisco, California. She has won numerous awards and has earned a national reputation for her passion for free speech and expertise as a First Amendment litigator. So, when Young America's Foundation faced an unconstitutional restraint by Berkeley to prevent students from hearing from one of our speakers, we called Harmeet. We needed the very best representation. So, we hired Harmeet and filed a lawsuit in federal court on April 24th. On that day, Harmeet took control of the narrative when she held a press conference announcing our lawsuit and eviscerated the administrators at Berkeley. Those are not my words. Those are the words of the many reporters and commentators who watched in awe as Harmeet explained Berkeley's blatant unconstitutional violation of student rights. That press conference has been viewed on YouTube more than 110,000 times. Harmeet's expertise, experience, and passion for the First Amendment make her truly unique. We are grateful for all she is doing to champion the free speech rights of students at Berkeley and across the country. Please join me in welcoming Harmeet Dhillon.
Thank you, Kimberly, for that warm introduction and for inviting me to be here today to share some of my experiences with the Berkeley case, as well as my background, and give all of you some tips and suggestions at the end of my comments about how to deal with these types of issues on your own campuses, and then there's going to be some time for Q&A as well. So, Kimberly mentioned my travails with free speech at Dartmouth. I just came from a radio interview with my good friend Laura Ingram, who was on the board of the Dartmouth Review when I was at Dartmouth. Dinesh D'Souza was also on the board. So I had some good teachers and mentors when I was a young college student at Dartmouth, and those are some of my best friends today. And we're still fighting the same battles, which is kind of disappointing, but I think the stakes are actually higher now than they were when I was at Dartmouth, and I'll explain that. So to set the stage here, and I hope I don't bore you with too much dry constitutional law, but I'm sure most of you know that the First Amendment is part of the Bill of Rights, and it's sort of the cornerstone of our concept, and it's one of the really unique things about the American democratic ethos is that we have this concept of free speech. Most countries around the world don't have it. Even other democracies don't have free speech rights to the extent that we do. And freedom of thought and speech and freedom of association are natural rights. Those are what the founders of our country believed to be rights that are God-given and not rights given by the government. They're inherent rights. But today, on our college campuses, the concept of free speech has somehow, like a cancer, it's metastasized to be a concept of being free from speech. I'm sure all of you have experienced this on your campuses, that there are bullies there who will view your free speech as something that infringes on their right or perceived right to be free from speech that is critical or that challenges them. And so that's kind of the new spin that we have here today, is that when I was at Dartmouth, we were kind of free to be somewhat obnoxious to a point, and then that point came where, like I said in the New York Times interview, where there was just this massive violent reaction, really, and we were put on the defensive. And if it hadn't been for some lawyers who helped us out in that situation, actually, I wouldn't be standing here today as the lawyer and free speech activist that I am. So the idea of campus unrest and ideological and generational clashes on campus is not new. I studied ancient Greek and Latin at Dartmouth, and that was my major. And so at Dartmouth, we learned about the classics, and we learned what happened to Socrates. And so Socrates was an early campus controversy, if you will. He had his students who he was teaching, and Socrates answered some questions from some students. And the way he answered those questions about the deities of the city, who are the gods, do you recognize these gods, that troubled the elders, the political infrastructure there of the city. And they decided that Socrates needed to be put on trial for his heretical views. And ultimately, he was sentenced to death for not believing in the gods of the city and the other sin of teaching the students about some other gods or some other beliefs, the beliefs and challenge and rhetoric and free exchange of ideas. Well, so that's what happened to Socrates, but today it's actually the professors at our universities who are putting free speech to death. They're the ones who are imposing their viewpoint on the students, and they're the ones who are stifling that very speech and that very American tradition of democracy out of existence. And those folks have tenure, and they've been there longer than you. And they're waging a war of attrition on the students. Most of you, I mean, the joke at University of California, Berkeley, is that you're on a 4, 5, or 6-year plan. People are not usually graduating in 4 years these days. But you're going to be gone in 4 or 5 years, and they're going to be there. They're going to be there for the next generation and the next generation after that. So they have the advantage of time. And so it really takes a lot of conviction and force of will to combat these powerful enemies of free speech. So you guys are the ones who are going to have to fight that war that Socrates once fought to bring enlightenment to the campuses. So with that, I'm going to have some slides here about the First Amendment, the threats on college campuses. And I have a slide about the text of the First Amendment. And this is relevant. It's what it says in its words is actually not what the law has evolved to be. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. Now, a lot of people look at the First Amendment and they say, well, it says Congress shall make no law and Congress shall not abridge the freedom of speech. So, okay, if Congress isn't making the law and Congress isn't abridging my speech, then they get to do that, right? No, the First Amendment has been broadened to include any action by the government. So University of California, Berkeley, which Kimberly mentioned, is a government university. And so any restrictions by the government on the government property or within the parameters of space controlled by the government is speech governed by the First Amendment. But it's even broader than that. Kimberly mentioned I was at Dartmouth. Well, Dartmouth is a private Ivy League institution. But a federal judge, federal judges and a state judge in our case ruled that because Dartmouth accepted federal funding, in that case I believe it was Title IX funding, Dartmouth, as well as a lot of other institutions of private institutions of higher learning, are also subject to certain First Amendment standards as well. So just because those of you in the audience may not be going to a state school, don't assume that the First Amendment doesn't apply to your speech as well. Just about every American institution nowadays in education takes government funding and therefore is also liable to follow the dictates of the First Amendment. So to give you a little bit of context, there was a free speech movement on campus that started at Berkeley, actually. I'll get to that in a minute. But, and I've talked about this. Okay, so the birth of the free speech movement is something that we know about from history. And in December 2nd, 1964, Mario Savio was a famous student activist at UC Berkeley. And he was let's call him a liberal. He was an anti-war activist. And he wanted to, and the university administration at that time was conservative. So they did not want students talking about the war and protesting, and students were being threatened with punishment for that. So he was not having any of this. He gave up, and he was a civil disobedience activist who made a speech, a famous speech, about giving bodies upon the gears. In other words, which is sort of communist rhetoric. It's the idea of throwing your body on the gears of the machine to stop the machine from crushing from crushing the souls of people. He demanded to lift the ban of on-campus political activity and acknowledge the right of free speech and academic freedom. As a result of Mario Savio's activism at UC Berkeley, the famous Sproul Plaza and the steps of Sproul Plaza, which is an open plaza on the UC Berkeley campus, was made a designated public forum. So today, if you go to UC Berkeley, you will see that all kinds of, I'm trying to think of a polite word to say, all kinds of, I guess you could say hippies, countercultural people, bums, crazy people, these are the lingua franca of the Sproul Plaza these days. But anything goes. Anybody can come there, shout their crackpot theories, and have a place to talk. It's very interesting. I held a press conference. Kimberly mentioned a press conference. There was a second press conference that week at Sproul Plaza, and as we were giving the press conference, and my clients Troy Warden and Noeed Tomas were speaking there, we had all these crackpots circling around and shouting at us. So it was pretty distracting, and it was pretty interesting. So to the Dartmouth Review. So that's fast forward a few years. I was at Dartmouth in the 1980s. William F. Buckley Jr. was still alive, and he was kind of the patron of my newspaper, which had been founded a few years earlier. And we were inspired at the Dartmouth Review to present the conservative point of view. Dartmouth was a typical liberal institution, and at the time I was at Dartmouth, the big political issue on campuses was, when I joined it, it was two issues. One was calling for divestment of the university's endowment from South Africa. So any businesses that did business in South Africa, the students were agitating to ask the university to divest from those corporations. So that was issue number one. Issue number two was we had the war in Central America between the Contras and the Sandinistas, and most of the professors were favoring the communist side, the Sandinistas in that, and the Dartmouth Review and the students were very supportive of the anti-communist movement there. So those were a couple of the big issues on our campus. I'm paraphrasing, there are a lot of others. But we had incident after incident after incident where our student reporters would go in, expose something, expose a story, and then try to have an article follow up about it. And as these articles were exposing to the alumni and to the rest of the world what was going on at Dartmouth, for example, giving out RU486, an abortion pill, before it was allowed by the FDA, basically doing testing on students without authorization, things like that. We exposed some of these issues at Dartmouth, and we began to be getting the fire and getting a lot of negative attention from the administration. So this culminated in three of my colleagues at the Dartmouth Review being suspended indefinitely from Dartmouth after they heard about a Music 101 class. We had an African-American professor named Bill Cook. And Cook was famous for going off on these riffs or these rants about Ronald Reagan, how bad Ronald Reagan was. He would call white students honkies. He was really quite a character. So one of the young conservatives told one of our colleagues on the paper, hey, this is crazy. You should cover it. So the student went in and audio taped the class. Without permission, admittedly, just audio taped it. We published a transcript of it on the front page of the Dartmouth Review. And this went out to several thousand alumni who were subscribers of our paper. And it caused a national hue and cry. And Dartmouth alumni were calling the administration. The phone was ringing off the hook. I'm going to, take you out of my will. And, it was like the old codgers were really up in arms about this thing. So we thought we'd do a follow-up story like any good journalist. So my friend Chris Baldwin and a couple of others, they went to talk to the professor the week after for the follow-up issue to see what was his comment about the commentary that had ensued. And he basically assaulted the students. So there was a photographer among the crew, and then there were two editors. And there are photographs showing the professor coming closer and closer to the photographer before he grabs the camera and throws it to the ground. And so then there's a disciplinary hearing of the students, not the professor. And we had something called the Orwellian name, the Committee on Standards at Dartmouth. And the Committee on Standards was some professors who heard this case. They were like a little kangaroo court, star chamber, tribunal. One of them was known to have made negative remarks about the Dartmouth Review, and one of the students challenged his impartiality. And he said, no, I can be impartial, it's cool. So, of course, these three students were suspended indefinitely. And, I mean, think about it now. I'm sure some of you are in the same situation. These are all kids with bright futures ahead of them, and all of a sudden their careers stretching out for their entire lives are going to be impacted by this negative situation. So then there was a savior that came to the scene, and that was one of our board members knew some fancy lawyers at the ACLU. And the ACLU, Lawrence Tribe, actually, you know, had read about the situation. And so we got some volunteer lawyers from New York City to represent the Dartmouth Review to sue Dartmouth to reinstate the students. So there was a state lawsuit filed and a federal lawsuit filed. And long story short, the three students were reinstated. One of the reasons that the court gave was the faculty was biased against the students. They did not get a fair hearing. And, you know, ultimately we established the principle that the students could not be punished for their speech. So that was all while I was editor-in-chief. I was not one of the three students, but I presided over this lawsuit. And I actually switched my major at that point. I had been pre-med, and I thought this law thing was pretty cool, and it was pretty amazing to be able to sue your university and win. And so I switched. Well, as an aside, I think it was bad enough for my parents that I was majoring in ancient Greek, a fairly incredibly useless major, and they weren't really fond of lawyers either. My father's a doctor in a small town, so he wasn't really nuts about lawyers either. But, you know, they accepted my decision, and I went on to eventually, I was a journalist at the Heritage Foundation for a year before I went to law school, and eventually became a lawyer, and I've been practicing law for almost 25 years now. But that brings me to another institution that I attended, which also has had a seminal free speech case. So in the case of Rosenberger versus University of Virginia, and I believe the Rosenberger in question is actually a YAF student graduate, if I'm not mistaken. So I went to UVA Law School. This case happened a few years after I graduated. But the long story short is there was a Christian newspaper at the university. And the university had a student fund. I guess they raised this fund from an activity fee that's assessed on all the students, and it was supposed to be given out equally to different student groups. And so if you had a soccer paper or an atheist paper, let's take aside atheists. If you had a paper of, I don't know, some affinity group, underwater basket weaving publication, you could get money from the university to print your paper. Christian students asked for this support as well, a few hundred dollars, and they were denied the printing costs, and they took this case all the way to the United States Supreme Court. And University of Virginia's position was, well, first of all, we are denying this money to all religious-oriented publications. Well, the Christian group was the only one which had asked for the funding, so that was kind of a clever but not really availing argument. So they said, okay, if that doesn't work, we have limited funds. That was another argument. The court wasn't having any of that. And the United States Supreme Court pointed out that it was not speech about religion that was banned. But so the money could be used by the Underwater Basket Weaving Club to talk about paganism or whatever. So, you know, but a Christian group was not allowed to express its Christian views with the student funds. So ultimately, that case established the concept that exclusion of multiple views, so exclusion of all religious views, is as offensive as exclusion of only one view. And that scarcity of funds of a university, such as University of Virginia, and today we're going to use the same argument at Berkeley, is not permissible. Recent speech on campuses. So I think all of you, these are all incidents that have occurred in the last couple of years. Many of you may be familiar with them. We've had some recent drama on college campuses involving the University of Missouri. That's a fascinating story that goes back several years. And what I think is fascinating about that story, just as an aside, is there came a point in time when the university administration was under attack by the African-American students who were criticizing them. And I think it was beginning to affect funding for some of the sports programs. And so the coaches and the guys in charge of the athletic department turned on the administrators. They basically switched sides and started to side with the students who were agitating. And basically when that happened, I guess we know where the money really comes from and what really matters at that institution, the dean had to resign. Yale had an incident 2 years ago about cultural misappropriation. The administrator made the signal error of saying that Halloween costumes that offend you, be it a geisha or a Cherokee costume, is protected free speech. Well, this drove the students nuts. Princeton students staged a sit-in at the university office for 32 hours, demanding that Woodrow Wilson's name be removed from campus buildings. Now, Woodrow Wilson has over time been viewed and is now openly called a racist. I think that's a bit harsh, but definitely he had views that are out of the mainstream of what we call the mainstream speech today. And so eliminating his name from campuses all over the country is now a big thing. I read a story as I was on the plane over here yesterday about a similar trend in Oregon, and apparently there's a school district in Oregon that has decided that it must remove the name of a famous family donor that's been on the schools for 100 years. The name of the family is Lynch. Well, the Lynch family donated a few million dollars to the school district 100 years ago. And the reasoning of the district now is, the word Lynch has very negative connotations for many students. And so even though the Lynch family wasn't actually lynching people, and even though it's Oregon, not where the slavery was occurring, forget all of that, that name has to come down. So that's the kind of political correctness we're seeing everywhere. You all know this. Then we've had incidents involving Ben Shapiro being disinvited from DePaul University. He was then subsequently threatened with arrest there at DePaul. And then we've had the incidents that bring us up to the UC Berkeley situation. So it seems like so long ago now, but it's really only been this semester that we've had this much drama there at UC Berkeley. And as an aside, I'm a former chairman of the San Francisco Republican Party, and I serve on the RNC, and I've had over a decade of interactions with the members of the UC Berkeley College Republicans. It's a great club. It's been sometimes the largest Republican club in the country. And up until this year, they were actually pretty free to bring students on. The students were free to invite conservative speakers onto their campus. It really wasn't a controversy, but what happened was we had this very contentious election last year. And after several years, I want to say more than 12 years, of a fairly stable, liberal, progressive mayor there in Berkeley, he decided he wasn't going to run for re-election. And what we got instead was a younger Latino mayor who is very vocal about illegal immigration issues. He's also vocal about renters' rights. A part of his platform was allowing longer partying hours at Berkeley. So, he really appealed to the student vote, and I think that's how he got elected. Well, this guy is a member of By All Means Necessary. He's a supporter of that group. He's a supporter and sympathizer, some allege, of the Antifa, or Antifa I call them, but I guess they'd like to be called Antifa, on the campus. And so he was not a big fan of Milo Yiannopoulos coming to the campus, as you can imagine. So my friends at the Berkeley College Republicans invited Milo to come speak on the campus. And before that he had been canceled from speaking at UC Davis, which is about an hour away from our campus. To their credit, the university did give Milo a place and give the Berkeley College Republicans a place to let that speech occur. And they also allowed them to have the speech in the evening. They did impose a very significant fee on the speech. It was several thousand dollars. I think they hoped that if they imposed a large tax on the speech, eventually the students would say it's not worth it, they couldn't raise the money. Well, the students raised the money, and they were all set for this event. Milo was going to come. Milo was alleged to be planning, I don't know who planted this rumor, but Milo was alleged to be planning to out or identify Dreamer students on the campus. I don't know if that's true or not, but that was the reasoning used by the mob to come there and disrupt this event. So I think a lot of you may have seen this video. It made international headlines, where basically these thugs, about 100 plus of them, wearing masks and wearing black clothes, came armed with metal bats and set fires in downtown Berkeley, which is a lovely, lovely town. And there were hundreds of police there, and they just stood there and watched. They did not make any arrests for the most part. This riot went on for hours, and of course the event was canceled. There was an imminent threat to safety, and the event got canceled. What we've subsequently learned is that because of the Occupy Wall Street protests earlier this decade, In 2014, Berkeley, City of Berkeley was sued by Occupy rioters who were arrested. They were sued for wrongful arrest in violation of their civil rights. So the City of Berkeley entered into a settlement agreement with the rioters, what we call a consent decree, and they basically agreed that unless somebody's about to be killed, the police are not going to step in and intervene. So I didn't know that was the policy. I'm sure my friends at the Berkeley College Republicans didn't know that was a policy, but that's the policy you see on the screen there. There were merely property damage. It was merely Starbucks being broken into. It was merely windows being broken and flames and people being beaten on the head with metal bars, and the police have a policy not to intervene. So that's the backdrop against which we come to our later events in the semester. So let's see here. So before I get to that, though, earlier this year as well, all in the same semester in other campuses, we had Heather McDonald, who was being prevented from speaking at Claremont McKenna College, also in California, a private institution in Southern California. We have a federal judge ordering Auburn University to allow white supremacist Richard Spencer to speak on the campus where violence erupted. It was a really unfortunate scene there. UC Santa Cruz made a protest also in California, turned violent with passerby and police officers assaulted. And then just about a couple months ago, Evergreen State College has got this ongoing protest going on with violent armed agitators protesting carrying bats and clubs on the campus. So fast forwarding to our situation at UC Berkeley, what happened was, let me go back a slide there. So Berkeley College Republicans worked with YAF. They weren't deterred by this Milo situation. Milo had moved on to other stuff. They wanted to bring Milo back. But meanwhile, they already had a program to bring conservative speaker David Horowitz to campus. Horowitz is one of the YAF stable of speakers. And you know, actually, incidentally, somebody who I heard speak at Dartmouth. And I co-wrote a chapter in his book, actually, Second Thoughts on the 60s. So he's a great conservative speaker. But the university's response was as follows. They said, okay, you can let this dude come speak, but you know, safety concerns, he's conservative, so okay, he can't speak late. He can't speak after like 3 o'clock. Okay, well, the student said, we're in class until 3 o'clock. I mean, how's that gonna work? Well, you're not all in class, so some people can go see him speak. Okay, where can we have him speak? Over there, like 2 miles away from the center of campus, like bus distance away from the center of campus. During classes, okay, that's gonna be hard, okay. But on top of that, we strongly encourage you not to publicize this event in any way. Don't put it on your social media. And by the way, if you invite outsiders off the campus to come, we're gonna charge you extra security fees for that. So, can't speak in the middle of campus, can't speak during a time when students can come hear him speak, can't publicize the event, and can't invite people from the local community, which might make it feasible to pay the security fee. So what I call the coup de grace of this whole situation was, the students gamely moved forward with this, by the way. They tried to accept all of these conditions. And then the university said, by the way, the security fee is going to be $5,700. Okay, so by the time all those restrictions that funneled down the number of people who could come listen to this speech had been in place, they had like 30 students. So, I mean, you guys are smart. They did the math. Did they really want to pay a $200 per student tax to the university to hear David Horowitz speak? David Horowitz is great, but, you know, running the math, that did not make sense. So they decided that it wasn't worth the inconvenience, and that event was canceled. Now, that was the same month as the Ann Coulter event, so let's talk about that. In the Ann Coulter situation, Berkeley College Republicans actually paired with another conservative, or not conservative, but another student organization on campus called Bridge Cal. Bridge Cal is a national nonpartisan student organization, and their goal is to come and bring speakers on the campus who are, you know, on interesting topics. So they decided that the topic of this particular speaker series they wanted to have was illegal immigration. Timely, Milo was supposedly going to out these dreamers, and you know, it's a big issue in the press. The president's spoken up a lot about it. So they approached the Berkeley College Republicans to see if Berkeley College Republicans would help them bring a conservative speaker to campus. Berkeley College Republicans said, sure, we can help you with that. And so they proposed to the university several weeks before the event, I believe it was a little bit over 6 weeks before the event, that they were going to have a Clinton administration deputy chief of staff come and speak about the pro-illegal immigration. I know illegal immigration, it's like rude, but that's what I call it. The pro-undocumented peoples, the pro-undocumented students, the pro-undocumented people's situation. And then the Ann Coulter was going to come present the opposite side. So, you know, the nonpartisan group was okay with this, and we presented, my clients presented this to the university. YAF, again, graciously agreed to underwrite the cost of this event, so they were going to pay for Ann Coulter to come. And Ann Coulter happens to be an old friend of mine from back when I was in law school as well, and I know from her speaking career that, and YAF does as well, Ann is very concerned about her own safety. So she always has some, you know, ex-military bodyguards around whenever she's coming to a place like this, so YAF was going to pay for all of that. So they started making arrangements. They asked for a room that would hold the expected size of people. I believe they were expecting maybe 500 people. They were expecting a big crowd for this event. Ann draws a big crowd. The university allowed the Clinton administration official to speak in the evening, in the middle of campus, all the advertising that they wanted, no restrictions. And, you know, some people showed up. It wasn't that compelling. Nothing near 500. So let's be fair. I mean, I guess they looked and said, no one's going to come to this. So whatever, you can have it wherever you want. But when it came to Ann Coulter, they kept giving the university, the university kept giving the students the runaround. So first they said the same restrictions as David Horowitz. Well, you know, we have determined that there is a substantial risk of incidents occurring, and because of that, we need to take some security precautions to make sure that we don't have violence. And of course, we're going to charge you a security fee. We won't tell you what that is yet, but you're going to have to abide by some restrictions. So we said, okay, what restrictions? Well, there's a curfew, and they use the word curfew. There's a 3 p.m. curfew for this event. You can't have the event go past 3 p.m. So in other words, it can't even start at 3 p.m. It has to start at like 1 or 1:30 and end by 3 p.m. You can't have it in the middle of campus because that would make it easy for people to get to, and we don't want people to be able to get to it easily. You can't advertise the event until a few hours before the event. People off the campus are not allowed to come to this event. We not allow you to invite, let's say, Harmeet Dhillon, who is the chair of the San Francisco Republican Party. She can't come to this event. And so, back and forth. And Ann Coulter, and you know, actually accepted all of these restrictions, believe it or not. She was ready to come speak at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, you know, off campus, barely, and all of that, if they would just let her come speak. So when she finally agreed to all of these restrictions, and they were working Berklee College Republicans closely with the YAF, the university said, actually, guess what? All the rooms are booked. We don't have any rooms for you at all, so sorry. But she can come in the fall. That's cool. Now, the then president of the Berklee College Republicans was about to graduate. This is an argument that I made. It's like, you know, this guy's going to graduate. He's never going to see this speech then. I mean, so there is an imminent need for us to actually adhere to the request that we have the speech on schedule. So then... This began to get some publicity. YAF, working with Berklee College Republicans, got a lot of publicity around this situation, and so the college offered an alternative. The alternative offered by Cal was she can come speak between the end of classes and exam time, the 1 week when, you know, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with our campus system there, but you know, a lot of students leave the campus. It's the reading period. They're not required to go into any classes. And but they were going to impose the same restrictions, 1 or 3 o'clock curfew, and you know we're not going to tell you where it is until right before the event, and you're going to have to pay several thousand dollars of security costs. So you know at that point we said no, enough is enough. We've agreed to all of your conditions. It's not happening. And so YAF, Kimberly and Mark, her other lawyer on the team here, they called me and asked me if I could help. And I've been a longtime activist in free speech issues dating back to Dartmouth, but other incidents as well. And so this was a Thursday. The speech was scheduled to be the following Thursday. And, you know, logistics had already been arranged. These three bodyguards had already had their tickets booked. They were going to come out and do a security assessment, make sure it was all going to be good. Ann was already ready. She was very fired up about this, and she had, you know, been, I'm sure all of you have seen her on social media and on Hannity talking about this case. So she was very fired up. She wants to speak. So we have to, you know, then confront the university. So they hired me, and I wrote a letter to the university that evening, the same day I was hired. I wrote a detailed letter to them saying, look, you're violating the First Amendment of the United States Constitution. You cannot have illegal time, place, and manner restrictions on the students. Whatever you allow other people, like this lame, you know, Clinton administration person, you got to give the same time slot to Ann Coulter. And they said, so the response from the university the next day was a Friday afternoon. I remember it well because it was addressed to Dear Mr. Dhillon. So you know, for me as a lawyer, I have an unusual name. I was born in India. So my lawyer hat goes on, and what I'm thinking, and I forward this to my clients, and I forward this to my my staff, and I'm thinking, as a lawyer, you're thinking, wow, this lawyer is really not doing a good job, because the first thing you do as a trial lawyer is you look up who you're dealing with. I mean, I'm going to respond differently if I'm dealing with the guy who's got, you know, the mesothelioma ads, or, you know, the guy who's unemployed. I'm going to be dealing with that lawyer differently than a First Amendment lawyer who's actually also a member of the Republican National Committee, a fairly prominent lawyer in California. So this dude just types out this letter and, like, Dear Mr. Dhillon. So now my clients were split on this. Some of them thought, they're just messing with you, Harmeet. You know, they know you're a woman, they know who you are, and they're just trying to insult you, and they misgendered you. And I was like, what's that? So I, like, pull out my phone. Oh my God, they misgendered me. They sure did. So I wrote a letter back to the lawyer, campus counsel, and I said, you know, Dear Mr., you know, whatever. I said, first of all, I have to say, you know, of all people, I'm so disappointed as a, you know, taxpayer and as a California resident that you of all people would misgender me, and. It's deeply troubling. Thank you. So, and please, let's not let that happen again. So, but what's really hilarious about that is this guy and other people in the administration, you can see exhibits from the complaint. These are people whose signature blocks say, my preferred gender pronouns are, like, you know, this guy named John Smith. My preferred gender pronouns are he, him, and her. So that's the level of political correctness on the campus itself, yet they don't extend the same courtesy to outsiders. I think that's kind of symptomatic of the problems here. So bad lawyering, lack of attention to detail, and just generally, I don't care. So that's kind of the response we got from the university. So my colleagues and I and my law firm filed a lawsuit. We worked around the weekend, really almost sleepless for 72 hours, and we filed a civil rights lawsuit on Monday morning, again, 4 days before Ann Coulter was supposed to speak. And it asserts federal claims in federal court of federal civil rights violations. And, you know, I don't want to bore you with the detail, but there are reasons that you don't assert state claims in defamation cases in California because of a concept called anti-SLAPP. But we filed allegations involving the First Amendment and then equal protection and due process as well. So the allegation is the students were denied their rights of speech. The students, mind you, not Ann Coulter. So Ann Coulter is not a plaintiff in this case. It is the rights of the students that were being suppressed and implicated by UC Berkeley's conduct. And so our lawsuit seeks to vindicate the important principle that where the University of California, Berkeley allows outsiders to come and speak on its campus, like Sonia Sotomayor, like the Dalai Lama, like Al Gore, like Vincent Quesada Fox, the former president of Mexico, who came and trashed Donald Trump the week before Ann Coulter was supposed to speak. When they allow outsiders to come speak on campus, they have to allow conservative students equal access to those facilities, and they cannot allow what's called a heckler's veto to interrupt and bar the speech. And the heckler's veto is what I alluded to earlier, where they said that we anticipate a violent reaction to Ann Coulter's speech. Ergo, we are going to make it very difficult for you to have that speech. And that is not a close case. That is blatantly unconstitutional under United States constitutional law. So where are we in that case? The case is now the university hired a very good lawyer, law firm, Munger, Tolles & Olson, very fine firm. And one of their lawyers actually crashed my press conference, very, very tacky, I must say. They hadn't even been, the lawsuit had barely been filed, and they sent an associate over to crash my press conference. But luckily, I had a good Republican press person who got rid of that lady. So we kicked the interloper out and went on and had our press conference, which was very satisfying. And I got fan mail from liberal lawyers all over the country about this lawsuit. And, you know, you may get jaded as conservative students on campus to think that you're really on your own here, but actually there are a lot of people around the country who don't share your political views, who do share the concept that our government cannot discriminate on the basis of viewpoint. And so that was really very heartening to me, because I'm used to being the minority. I'm the, you know, Republican lawyer in San Francisco, and, you know, it's been tough my entire career, frankly. But, you know, it was really nice to get that fan mail from around the country, and pretty much to a man and woman, all the lawyers who practice in this area of law agree that there is no legal justification for the university to treat the Berklee College Republicans and their invitees the way that they have. So let me give you some tips and some tools. Let me say actually where the case is now. There's a motion to dismiss. So in the end of September, we're going to argue the motion to dismiss that these lawyers have filed. Their arguments are that include that the policy that we're talking about, the argument is, it isn't really well-settled law. The First Amendment jurisprudence that I've gone over and cited cases here is not really well-settled. That's one of the arguments. So that's, frankly, silly. And then we haven't pled sufficient detail. I think we have, and I'm pretty confident about our chances there. But most importantly, they've actually issued a new policy. So they actually asked me to put the lawsuit on hold a few weeks ago because they were issuing a new policy. I said, I don't think so. And so they went ahead and issued the new policy. It's a very obtuse 22-page policy. It's very difficult to understand, and I think it's unconstitutional. So we are moving forward with our lawsuit. And if they want to come to the table and agree to give equal access to conservative students on their campus, then we can talk. Otherwise, we are going to ask a federal judge to make sure that happens. And we are prepared to take this case all the way. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So let me end my prepared remarks by giving you some tools, some news you can use. Okay, so here are some things you should know your rights on the college campus. Campus speech restrictions cannot be content-based. In other words, they cannot bar you in a college, as opposed to a high school, from covering certain topics. The heckler's veto that I described cannot be allowed. You cannot bar somebody's speech in anticipation of the speech based on the expected negative reaction of the listeners. The university cannot gouge you with unjustified security fees. And this issue has not yet been litigated in our case, but I suspect it will be. The university has imposed fees of $3,000, $4,000, $10,000 on Berklee College Republicans in efforts to get them to drop their events. And this is actually unconstitutional. You cannot give this type of a restriction as a proxy. I call it a tax. I call it a speech tax. These are unconstitutional, and there's a long line of cases on that. Students have every right to use the public spaces of the university, with very few exceptions. So, and by public, I mean even semi-public, designated forums as well as limited purpose forums on the university campus. The key restriction is you cannot make a use of the university space that excludes its primary use. So, I mean, you can't run, I'm trying to think, you can't run an auto auction, you know, off of, you know, the Sproul Plaza or Zellerbach Hall. It's not, if the crowds are going to interfere with other people going to classes and doing their business, that's not permitted. But short of that, almost any type of lecture by any cuckoo speaker should be allowed on a university campus. There is no constitutional right to be free from offense. And this is something that there was a lot of garbage political and legal analysis going on right after we filed our lawsuit. I would turn on the news and I would see people on CNN and MSNBC saying, you know, oh, well, you know, hate speech, of course, is not, I mean, I think actually Howard Dean said, of course, hate speech is not covered by the Constitution. And I think I responded in a tweet, I said, you know, this is what happens when amateurs attempt to practice constitutional law. He's an amateur. Because Howard Dean hate speech is protected by the United States Constitution, CEG, the Nazis marching in Skokie, Illinois. So very well settled law. And then finally, I have some strategies for you. So I'm sure all of you, many of you, I shouldn't say all of you, but many of you come from campuses where your viewpoint is not the dominant viewpoint. Let's start with that assumption. If you want to have events on your campus that are successful and you think you may run into some roadblocks like my friends at the Berklee College Republicans and like my friends at YAF have run into on multiple campuses, start by following the rules, and for that you got to start by knowing the rules. So read the rules. There should be some written rules somewhere as to how people are brought to campus. Follow those rules. My friends at Berklee followed the rules. You usually have to propose a speaker and then ask for a space, and then there's this back and forth. Get it all in writing. Now, what the university often wants you to do is come to a private meeting with them where there'll be one or two of you, and those are the people who are going to give you your degree and or maybe, you know, crush your entire life, blood, and career right there at the age of 18, and or not. So what do you think, students? So don't be intimidated by that. Try to do as much as you can in writing, or at least confirm everything in writing. If you are required to have a meeting with the university, confirm it in writing. I would also suggest that you be strategic in who you invite. I mean, I probably wouldn't have invited Richard Spencer, for example, as a speaker. That's just my taste. I'm not saying you can't, but, you know, if you want to be the conservative group or the group with some credibility, and if you want to win people over to your side, you know, think carefully about who you invite. They should be persuasive, outgoing, attractive, like rational speakers, even speakers who are very conservative, or even liberal speakers if you want. Bring liberal speakers, bring two speakers. But I think it makes you look better if you're attempting to enrich the educational atmosphere at your school. And then I recommend, and this requires a little bit of guts and the guidance of a lawyer, I recommend if you have a speech and you expect there to be protesters, et cetera, videotape everything. Have your students who have a little bit of skill in that set up and videotape it, because you will be accused of starting it. You will be accused of being the instigator. Your instigation, which didn't occur, will be used as the justification for some punishment afterwards. So make sure there's a video record. And I find that very salutary in many encounters. Just make sure there's a record, and I think that really helps back people off. And the university or the college has unlimited resources. I mean, they pay professors hundreds of thousands of dollars generally. Deans that, you know, we have Janet Napolitano as the head of the UC system, and she gets paid a lot of money. And so, don't go into battle unarmed. Don't go into battle, you know, with the tank with a slingshot. So that leads me to my final slide, which is, if your speech is silenced, get some help. There are a number of conservative, and not just conservative, but pro-free speech lawyers out there who can help you. There are conservative lawyer groups. The Republican National Lawyers Association is one group that I serve on the board of, and they have chapters all over the country. There's a Federalist Society, which is a nonpartisan conservative lawyers group, which I was involved with at University of Virginia. Local Bar Association may have young lawyers who may not share your views, but let me tell you, First Amendment law is the sexiest thing for lawyers. I mean, everybody wants to do it. And if you're a lawyer who's interested in intellectual issues, even if you're a liberal, I found a lot of lawyers, like I said, the ACLU represented my friends at Dartmouth. In some states, probably not in my area, but the ACLU may actually help you themselves. And the way that organization works is they have chapters, and each chapter is independent. So you may find in Alabama, the ACLU chapter may be willing to help you as a conservative student there, whereas in Northern California, forget it. Then there are some nonprofit groups. And I won't name them, but there are a bunch of groups out there that handle these types of cases. They are sort of founded for conservative free speech. My final point, again, this is a sort of a pro tip. If you are involved in a dispute with your university and you think you might need a lawyer, ask the lawyer before you start tweeting, Snapchatting, Facebooking, et cetera, about it, because you don't want your communications on these issues to undermine your legal strategy or your ultimate goals. So those are my tips and my points here, and I am happy to take any questions if I have any time left. Am I calling on the... I guess he got to the mic first.
Okay. My name's Scott. I'm from the University of Arkansas. I just kind of wanted to play devil's advocate talking about restricting funding with private universities. So in regards to the First Amendment protection of free assembly, I believe that this affords private universities the right to assemble as they choose under their own belief, and therefore limit speech as a private entity, such as Brigham Young University. And I think that holding schools hostage with the threat of cutting federal funding will serve as a death sentence threatening any school's ability to remain open that do not have endowments as large as that of Harvard or completely free of federal financial assistance, such as the College of the Ozarks, without full compliance to these new financial holdings. So do you believe that if this route is taken to protect free speech, the due process of this will reflect that of the failed application of Title IX enforcement? And if so, do you think that this is an appropriate trade-off for free speech rights of students that attend the university willingly over the rights of the private university and set a dangerous precedent in the aspect of restricting private groups' First Amendment rights over that of its voluntary members?
Okay, so that's what I call a speech masked as a question. But to answer the question that is wrapped up in that, I think I already did, but you are free as a university to take 0 pennies of federal dollars. And if you take 0 pennies of federal dollars, there's a very good argument that the First Amendment does not apply to your campus. Almost all universities, including most private universities in this country, do accept some federal funding. And that is a deep philosophical issue. When you take money from the federal government, you open your door to the federal government regulating what you do. So it's really simple. If you don't want to be subject to the First Amendment, don't take federal funds. Next question.
Hi, my name is Ashley. I go to the University of Texas at Austin, and unsurprisingly, in the last year, we've had to deal with a lot of these type of issues. My question is, concerning speaking fees, at what point should you be concerned that they're trying to gouge you? And also, what we deal with often is an administration that just slows things down until we never hear back and it's too late. What can we do to prevent that?
Okay, great question. Number one, what is too much in terms of speaker's fees and what can you do about the war of attrition, the slow walking your request? There is no bright line, but the courts have held that a activity fee that seems to vary by who the speaker is probably suspect. So I've seen cases that say that sort of if there's a $1,000 per event fee charged to every event on the campus, that's cool. But if you're charging $1,000 to the Clinton administration guy hosts and you're charging $20,000 to Ann Coulter hosts, that's illegitimate. And, you know, the way that they do it at UC Berkeley is they estimate, based on their threat assessment, how many people they're going to need. So I'm not going to be surprised to see when we bring Ben Shapiro there this semester that they're going to need 100 police officers to check all the bags. And, you know, whereas, let's say, Sonia Sotomayor's event might need 5 police officers. So that's a form of a tax, too. So. Just to make a record of it, I mean, it's really good to ask the university for examples of what they've charged prior student groups, keep a record of that, and just, you know, create a track record. It may not be during your semester, your event, that you're able to bring a lawsuit, but make sure there's some institutional knowledge. And then as to the slow walking, it's the same thing. You have to create a record. So you have to consider this to be in the long game for your club, whatever your club or your group is. You may not be able to prove your case this time or even the next time, but if you create a good record of all of those incidents and how, and by the way, I think, you know, having good relationships with your friends who don't share your views. So maybe your roommate or somebody on your lacrosse team or whatever, they're in a group, and it turns out their group, their application got approved for their event in 3 days, and yours never got approved. Keep a record of that and make a record of that, and that will help. And like I said, I think there are a lot of free lawyers out there who can give advice throughout the country. You just need to find one. It's really not that hard. If you have trouble finding somebody, I'm sure, you know, YAF might be able to help. I might be able to help. You know, we all have a network of lawyers around the country to help you document these issues.
Thank you. Next question.
Hi, my name's Greg. I go to Sacred Heart University in Connecticut. And this is a pretty general question, but I'd like to hear different perspectives on it. Where do you think this whole mentality of the campus left comes from? You know, like the whole snowflakery, fascist kind of thing, where if, you know, someone says there are only two genders, they get triggered to the point of violence.
Yeah, that's a good question. And, it's just like when I was a kid, you know, it's actually the same thing when I was a kid, only now, when I was a kid, it was, you know, Sandinistas were good and Contras were bad, but now it's like, you know, gender fluidity and a lot of things that I think are really dangerous and damaging in the long term of our society. So generally speaking, and I'm sorry to smear my friends who are professors, but generally speaking, academics are liberal. I recall a study at Dartmouth where I went, I think it was literally 99% of the professors had voted for, you know, voted not for Ronald Reagan, I think. And, you know, so they have a liberal attitude to start with. And I think it's kind of a lazy, cushy place, to be honest with you, and it's an easy place for people who have time on their hands to take up causes that are found to be trivial and silly by those of us who hold down 9-to-5 or 9-to-10 jobs. And so, you know, these bad ideas fester, and I think you use the term metastasize, and, you know, I once called San Francisco the utopian petri dish of America. And that's kind of what happens there on these campuses, and then they propagate. And I don't know if these students come to campus pre-baked with these insane ideas that nobody should challenge them, but I saw Adam Carolla testifying in Congress. Some of you may have seen his testimony last week. He talked about the advent of helicopter parents and how helicopter parents have basically shielded their kids from germs and shielded their kids from any kind of antigen or allergen or anything that might little, you know, move a hair on Johnny's head, that's not allowed. And then when these same coddled, spoiled kids come to the campuses, they, you know, they can't take a contrary view. So that's the parents' fault. But then we all have to live with the bad parenting of the liberal parents. I mean, I know when I was a kid, if I disagreed with my parents on something, they won. I mean, there really wasn't any conversation about it. And so, you know, I didn't really have a hard time coming to Dartmouth and encountering other ideas. But anyway, that's my pop psychology analysis. So, yes.
Thank you, and thank you for everything you do.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Samir, and I go to Bunker Hill Community College. And I plan on transferring to a private four-year school after I'm done with community college. And I wanted to know, how do you find out that private school's funding and how they receive federal money?
That's a good question. I'm not sure I know the answer in very big detail, but generally there are records of all of these things. I mean, you could actually call up the university and ask them, what kind of federal funding do you get? I'm interested in knowing that before I transfer to your school. I mean, you're entitled to know that. Your family, your parents are taxpayers. And so that's a good question. The general avenue whereby the federalism is put onto these private institutions is via Title IX funding to equalize sports, you know, between women and men. If you take any of that money, you know, but then there's Pell Grants. There's any kind of grants that come from the federal government. So if the school accepts federal money for research, so if the research is being funded by the NIH or something like that, all of those are avenues of federal funding that may subject the university to First Amendment analysis. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you.
I think we're out of time. Well, thank you all for your attention today. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon.